Welcome to this week's edition of Understanding Scripture with Father Dave. Father Dave Nuss is a priest of the Diocese of Toledo, a graduate of Marquette University, Mount St. Mary's Seminary, and the Catholic University of America. Father Dave examines readings that will be heard at this Sunday's Mass to help listeners better understand the Scriptures.
Hi, this is Father Dave. Thanks for tuning in. Friends, this is the opportunity for us to share in conversation regarding God's Word, that it's God who speaks to us through the sacred Scriptures so that we may know Him and love Him and serve Him more wholeheartedly, more joyfully, and more obediently. And we do this by taking the Scriptures, which we will hear for the upcoming Masses this weekend, the 17th Sunday in Ordinary Time. And this Sunday, we are going to hear a short narrative piece from the second book of Kings. We are going to pray together Psalm 145. We will again hear a short section from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. And in what might seem a surprise in this particular year of the Gospel of Mark, we're actually going to hear from the Gospel of John, and not just this Sunday, but we're going to hear a continuation of the narrative given to us in the sixth chapter of John's Gospel. In this particular Sunday, the 17th Sunday in Ordinary Time, we will listen to a great miracle story that begins the very famous and well-known and powerful sixth chapter. The first reading from the second book of Kings may not be as familiar to everyone. Indeed, this Old Testament book contains many dramatic stories of the prophet Elisha and Elijah, primarily focusing upon Elisha, and the majesty and power of God working through the man of God, his anointed prophet. The first reading depicts a food miracle by Elisha that apparently looks to be a preview, a precursor, a foreshadowing of the multiplication of loaves as told in the gospel story by Jesus himself. The two accounts, this reading from the second book of Kings, the fourth chapter, and the multiplication of the loaves, as it is, we're going to hear John's version of that story, although Jesus' multiplication of the loaves is recorded no less than six different times in the four gospels. The two accounts are comparable in a number of details. In fact, it would be very instructive and helpful, a marvelous preparation for Mass, if you were able to take the time to line up those accounts next to each other, if you were, whether it's flipping back and forth in your Bible, or whether it's the opportunity to be able to do it online, being able to access God's Word there. In whatever way that you come about the source of God's Holy Word, to be able to look at the first reading and the Gospel side by side, if you will, to do a little bit of a consideration of the stories in terms of similarities. And we see these details in which they are similar. For example, in both stories, there's an insufficiency of available food. In both stories, a command is given to give the people something to eat. In both stories, the eating and the leftovers are details that are contained in the narrative. Now, of course, the first reading, this account from the second book of Kings, fourth chapter, in the first reading, the actual extent or reach of the miracle, well, it's much less than it is in the gospel with Jesus' multiplication of the loaves, though it certainly is no less miraculous. The food available is more plentiful. The crowd is larger in the gospel account. And the miracle takes place in both instances. And it does so how? It doesn't do so through human ingenuity or cleverness. It doesn't take place because of human scheming or conniving. Friends, a miracle is an attribute, a manifestation of the divine power, of God's own majesty on display and active, if you will, creating and transforming. The miracle takes place both in the first reading and in the gospel through the word from God. Still, we can see the similarities. Let's listen attentively, turning our attention to the second book of Kings, chapter 4, verses 42 to 44, the second book of Kings, chapter 4, beginning with verse 42. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing to Elisha, the man of God, 20 barley loaves made from the first fruits and fresh grain in the ear. Elisha said, "Give it to the people to eat." But his servant objected, "How can I set this before 100 people?" Elisha insisted, "Give it to the people to eat. For thus says the Lord, they shall eat, and there shall be some left over." And when they had eaten, there was some left over, as the Lord had said. How many times do we look over a situation only to conclude that something is impossible? We look at the resources that we have in our midst. We look at the needs that are so many before us, and we say, "I can't possibly make a difference. This can't possibly work out in the way that I want it to. I'm doomed. I'm done." That's it. Over and out. It's as if God is put on the sidelines altogether, for in such an example, the point of view is myself, not my God. And in this very short narrative, the man of God, which is the way that the prophet Elijah was introduced back in the 17th chapter of the first book of Kings, which is the same title that is given to Elisha, his successor, his God-appointed successor, Elisha draws attention to the power and to the majesty of God, that God wishes to provide those present in this situation with sustenance, with what they need. And there is a servant who objects. This can't possibly happen, for there are only 20 barley loaves made from the first fruits and the fresh grain in the ear. How in the world can I set this before 100 people? I can almost hear, if you will, or imagine, that's a better way of saying it, I can almost imagine a bit of sarcasm. "Yo, really? Go ahead, try to do it. It's not going to work." Human pride and human arrogance short circuits God's activities to be on display and to unveil his power far too often. The prophet, the man of God, Elisha, calmly and consistently simply says, "Give it to the people to eat." There is a need that the people have of hunger. There is a provision that is available in the barley loaves that the servant has. And the prophet, who is steadfastly rooted in relationship with God, knows God will provide. There's no indication here that the prophet knows exactly what God's provisions will be, only that God will take that which is present and through it provide for the needs of the people. Even though, from a worldly point of view, this is absurd. This can't be done. The prophet insists, "Give it to the people to eat." In fact, here, in my own imagining, I conjure up the image of the prophet being very calm, for he's so deeply rooted in the providential care of Almighty God that he doesn't need to pick up his voice or pick up his attitude so that it's more intimidating or threatening. "Just do what I tell you to do." No. When we are filled with a confidence, it enables us to speak and act calmly, definitively, without hesitation. We know in such instances that something is going to work out exactly as it's scripted. In fact, for those of you who are older with your own children or grandchildren, you know that it's a much more effective tactic to bring about compliance in your child or your grandchild by speaking how, calmly, gently, confidently, assertively, compassionately, not ratcheting it up so that it comes across as a threat. In fact, we can feel ourselves losing our footing when we do that in all of those instances. And sometimes when we ratchet up the volume and the pitch and the intensity of our insistence, sometimes that says more about our lack of confidence than it really does about the dire need of the situation. As always, God provides the people with what they need most in the moment. They had all eaten their fill, and some was even left over. And so we don't miss the point, just as the Lord had said. For those words of the prophet, "Give it to the people to eat," those words are the words of God spoken by the man of God. Don't be afraid to ask the Lord for that which you need, or an even more mature prayer, a riskier one, if you will, a prayer that even extends greater vulnerability within our own selves, is to ask the Lord to provide us with what we need, all that we need, instead of determining what our needs are in the moment. Please, Lord, provide me with what I need. That same prayer will be spoken differently by Jesus in the gospel as a part of a larger prayer that we are taught to pray in those famous and very difficult words, "Thy will be done." Let's turn our attention now to the second reading from Sacred Scripture for this Sunday, the 17th Sunday in Ordinary Time. And the second reading is taken from St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Friends, we've been listening to this particular work of St. Paul for several weeks. I remind you again of the theological density, the spiritual development. This is a very profound and rich, if you will, it's a rich tasting book of the Bible. It's not one to race through, but it's more of a multi-course meal that you just eat slowly and deliberately. The flavor is so intense. You just enjoy bite after bite after bite. This is not a book to race through, but God's Word in this particular New Testament book is really meant to be pondered carefully and thoughtfully. For this Sunday, we will listen to the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians in chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. So I invite you now to read along God's holy word, to open your Bibles if you have them, to St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians chapter 4, beginning with verse 1. "Brothers and sisters, I, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, one body and one Spirit, as you were also called to the one hope of your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." In a way, the second reading draws attention to Jesus' real multiplication of bread. That is, no less than the distribution of his sacred body in the Eucharist, which in the gospel account that we will be listening to shortly is promised to us, is foreshadowed for us in the multiplication of the loaves. In this particular letter from St. Paul in this chapter 4, what beautiful expressions Paul is inspired to make. Saint Paul, I, a prisoner for the Lord. I have to say that is not an expression that I have used recently to describe my own relationship with the Lord. Are my thoughts and my words so decidedly Christocentric, so unmistakably those of the Lord Jesus Christ himself, that I could refer to my own self as a prisoner for the Lord? Not of the Lord, but for him. That I want my mind, that I want my actions to be in perfect harmony with what has been established for me by no less than Christ himself. And there is a level of urgency with which Paul is exhorting those Christians in Ephesus, and with those Christians, the Christians of all times and of all places. And the urgency is that we dare to live in a manner that is worthy of the call that we have received. Notice here that faith is expressly a verb. It is to be lived. It is not merely to be memorized, but we see faith most profoundly by means of the choices that we make. And what is this manner that is worthy of the call that we have received? Well, Paul gives us very concrete and measurable units. All humility and all gentleness with patience, seen in bearing with one another through love, in striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Friends, this is a powerful examination of conscience, to be able to look at our day, both in the moment as well as at the end of the day, looking back, by means of how worthy we have chosen to live the manner of the call that we have received. Have humility and gentleness and patience been a part of my day? And if not, to ask forgiveness for those times of having lived in a manner that was unworthy of the call that I have received. Humility, gentleness, patience. When's the last time we heard those virtues trumpeted in the secular state in which we find ourselves? In fact, those qualities are scorned directly and indirectly, right? There's an impulse today to do what you want to do when you want to do it. Far from humility being exalted, in the worldly sense, we honor and we venerate those who are arrogant and pride-filled, those who set themselves beyond law, those who set themselves at time beyond scrutiny, beyond their own critical examination. Gentleness, that's not always a word that or a quality that is ascribed to this worthiness from a worldly sense, but rather aggression, assertiveness, take care of myself first, then with some remaining resources, including time, then I can take care of others, and patience. Boy, are these challenges numerous in our daily experiences. And yet we are to bear with one another in these ways through love. Friends, let me remind you, love is not a feeling. Love is an act of the will, and love is seen precisely in the choices that Jesus himself made, suffering for us and for our salvation. The cross is the greatest symbol of love that we have, so powerful that in the Catholic Christian tradition, the crucifix itself, rightly and appropriately, is placed at the center of so many of our Catholic Christian institutions. It's found in our Catholic school classrooms, not just in the school, in the hall on the inside door, but in every single classroom. For that is the way of life, which is the way of love. That is the way in which humility and gentleness and patience is seen, unlike any others, to which we all are called to emulate, to follow. after which we are to pattern our own lives, and to do this out of concern for one another. And in doing so, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. This is a piece of Christ-making, and this unity is a gift of the Holy Spirit. It's a manifestation of God's Spirit. The Spirit unifies. The opponent divides. When we're feeling divided and fragmented, that's a good indication that the Spirit at play is not the Spirit of Christ, but a dark and sinister spirit that is opposed to Christ. We are called to champion the unity of the Holy Spirit through the bond of peace, Christ's peace. Friends, let us turn our attention now to the gospel. The gospel, which this Sunday, as I mentioned previously, is taken from John's account. Now, a point of clarification, which is important because it surprises us that we switched to John's gospel. But beginning this Sunday, the 17th Sunday, and for the next 5 Sundays, we're going to follow the story of the multiplication of the bread. And then this following great discourse on the meaningfulness of the action as reported in the Gospel of John. These are very, very important gospel readings. And how wonderful it is that the church, in her love and care for us, in the middle of the summer, if you will, gives to us the opportunity to be reminded of the centrality of the Eucharist, the centrality of the Eucharist in our lives as Catholic Christian, and at the heart of what it means to be a community of faith or parish. John's gospel picks up from Mark's gospel. Namely, it picks up the setting for the multiplication of the loaves and the fishes, which we heard in last Sunday's scripture reading from Mark's 6th chapter. So we really transition quite easily into John's version of these events. In fact, if I hadn't drawn such emphasis to the fact that we're stepping into John's gospel from Mark's gospel, I dare say that would not have been readily apparent for everyone. Let's listen attentively to the reading from John's gospel, which will be our reading this Sunday. John chapter 6, verses 1 to 15. John chapter 6, beginning with verse 1. Jesus went across the Sea of Galilee. A large crowd followed him because they saw the signs he was performing on the sick. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. The Jewish feast of Passover was near. When Jesus raised his eyes and saw that a large crowd was coming to him, he said to Philip, "Where can we buy enough food for them to eat?" He said this to test him, because he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 200 days' wages worth of food would not be enough for each of them to have a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good are these for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people recline." Now there was a great deal of grass in that place, so the men reclined, about 5,000 in number. Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed them to those who were reclining, and also as much of the fish as they wanted. When they had had their fill, he said to his disciples, "Gather the fragments left over so that nothing will be wasted." So they collected them and filled 12 wicker baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves that had been more than they could eat. When the people saw the sign he had done, they said, "This is truly the prophet, the one who is to come into the world." Since Jesus knew that they were going to come and carry him off to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain alone. Friends, an important teaching with this particular story: this is not the institution of the Eucharist, but a foreshadowing, a precursor of the greatest of gifts that is to come, namely the very giving by Jesus of his own body and blood, his own soul and divinity to the Christian community. And what follows from this story, after a brief excursus about Jesus walking on water, will be an extended explanation by Jesus himself into the meaning of the bread from heaven. Just as the first reading is a precursor or indication, a connection of sorts with the gospel reading, so too does the multiplication of loaves really heighten our interest and desire for the greatest of gifts that God will give to us through Jesus at the Last Supper and at every single Holy Eucharist, at every single Holy Mass. Let's pray. O God, protector of those who hope in you, without whom nothing has firm foundation, nothing is holy, we ask you to bestow in abundance your mercy upon us, an abundance that is seen in the readings that we will savor this weekend. Grant that, with you as our ruler and our guide, we may use the many good things that pass in such a way as to hold fast even now to those that ever endure. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit come upon you, upon your parish communities, upon all the Catholic institutions throughout the 19-county Diocese of Toledo, now and forever. Amen. I hope to see you at Mass.
Thank you for listening to Understanding Scripture with Father Dave, produced by Annunciation Radio. Listen again next time as Father Dave Nuss again reviews and explains the readings from Sunday's Mass.